Welcome to the Strong Guy Storytime with me, the Strong Guy. Hi guys, so moving on from the Norse mythology that we did last time for the last few episodes, we're going to be doing, still with the Norse theme, we're doing the Saga of Ragnar Lothbrok and his sons. I'm going to read the blurb on the back. Although based on historical persons from the 9th century, Ragnar Lothbrok and his sons are the subjects of compelling legends dating from the Viking era. Mighty warriors, raiders and rulers, Ragnar and his sons inspired unknown writers to set down their stories over 7 centuries ago. This volume presents new and original translations of the 3 major Old Norse texts that tell Ragnar's story, the Saga of Ragnar Lothbrok and his sons, the Tale of Ragnar's Sons, and the Sorbligot, or Saga Fragment. Translations of Ragnar's death song, the Kraklumal, or Words of the Raven, and of a Latin fragment, List of the Swedish Kings, complete the story of Ragnar and his far-famed family. Extensive notes and commentary provide insights into the historical and mythological background of these timeless sagas. And this, I believe, has been translated by a Ben Wagoner, and it's available from Trough Publications. So, hope you enjoy. Today I'm going to do in chapters 1 to 10. So, this is part 1. The Saga of Ragnar Lothbrok. Chapter 1. In Hilimdale, Hæmir heard the news that Sigurd and Brynhild were dead. Aslaug, their daughter, and Hæmir's foster daughter, was 3 years old then. He now knew that enemies would seek to destroy the girl and all her family. But he grieved so much over the death of Brynhild, his foster daughter, that he cared neither for his own kingdom nor his wealth. He realized that he could not keep the girl there in secret. He had a harp made that was now so large that he put the girl Aslaug inside it, along with many precious objects of gold and silver. Then he went away and travelled widely throughout the land, and at last came to the Northlands. His harp was so skillfully made that he could take it apart and put it together at the joints, and on days when he came to waterfalls with no houses nearby, it was his custom to take the harp apart and bathe the girl. He had a wine leek, which he gave her to eat. Nature's leek is such that a person may survive for a long time, even if he has no other food. And when the girl cried, he would strike up his harp, and she would quieten down. For Hæmir was accomplished at those skills, which were practiced at the time. He also had many costly clothes in the harp with her, and much gold. Now he travelled until he reached Norway, and he came to a little farm that was called Sprengerid. An old man named Aki lived there. He had a wife, and she was called Grima. There were no other people than themselves. That day, the old man had gone to the forest, but the old woman was home. She greeted Hæmir and asked who he was. He said that he was a beggar and asked the old woman for shelter. She said that no one else came there, so she would welcome him if he thought he needed to stay. In the end, he said that he would be most comfortable if he could sit before a fire and then be shown to quarters where he might sleep. When the old woman had kindled the fire, he set the harp up and set himself next to it. The old woman was speaking excitedly, her gaze often lit on the harp. Because the fringe of the luxurious piece of clothing was hanging out of the harp, and as he warmed himself by the fire, she saw a costly gold ring sticking out from under his rags, because he was poorly dressed. He had warmed himself as much as he felt that he needed, then he had supper. After that, he asked the old woman to show him to the place where he should sleep that night. The old woman said that he would be better off outside the house than in, because my husband and I often talk a lot when he comes home. He asked her to decide. Then he went outside and so did she. He took the harp and kept it with him. The old woman went out to where there was a barley barn. She guided him there and said that he should settle down there, and said that she hoped that he would enjoy his sleep. And now the old woman went away and busied herself with the work she had to do, and he got ready for sleep. The old man came home as evening was coming on. The old woman had worked very little in what she needed to do. He was tired and grouchy. When he came home, when everything that she should have worked at was undone, the old man said that there must be a great difference in her happiness, since he worked every day more than he was able, but she didn't feel like doing anything useful. "Don't be angry, my husband," she said, because you may be able to work for just a little while to make the two of us happy all our lives. What is it? Said the old man. The old woman answered, A man has come to our lodgings, and I think he has plenty of money with him for travelling. He is bent by old age, but he must have been the greatest of champions once. Yet now he's very weary. I don't think that I've ever seen anyone like him, but I think that he is exhausted and asleep. Then the old man said, I don't think it's right to betray the few people who come here. She answered, That's why you'll always be a weakling. Everything looks too big to you. Now do one of two things. You kill him, or I'll take him for my own husband and will drive you away. I can tell you the words that he said to me this evening, though they'll seem unworthy to you. He spoke seductively to me. That will be my plan, to take him as my own man and drive you away or kill you. Do you want to do what I want? It said that the old man was ruled by his wife. She talked until he gave in to egging him on. He took his axe and sharpened it a great deal. When he was ready, the old man led him to where Hemi was sleeping. He was snoring loudly. Then the old woman said to the old man that he should make his attack as best he could and get away quickly, because you won't be able to withstand his bellowing and shouting once he gets his hands on you. She took the harp and ran off with it. Now the old man came up to where Hemi was sleeping. He struck at him and gave him a great wound, and the axe got loose from him. He ran away from there as fast as he could. Hemi awoke at the blow, and was quite enough for him. It is said that his death throes made such a great din that the pillars of the house fell down, and the entire house collapsed, and there was a great earthquake, and there he lost his life. Now the old man came to the old woman and said that he had killed him. And for a moment, I didn't know how it would go. This man was incredibly mighty, but I suppose that he is now in hell. The old woman said that he would have her thanks for the deed, and I expect that now we too will have enough money. We'll find out whether I have spoken the truth. Now they kindled a fire, and the old woman took the harp and tried to open it. She couldn't get it open in any other way than breaking it, because she didn't have the skill. But once she got the harp opened up, there she saw a girl child, and she thought that she had ever seen anyone like her. There's also much money in the harp. Now the old man said, This will now turn out as it often does. When someone betrays the one who trusted him, it ends badly. It seems that we have a dependent on our hands. The old woman answered, This is not going as I planned. No harm will come of it. And now she asked the girl what family she came from. But to this the young girl gave no answer, as if she had not learned speech. Now our plan will turn out badly. Just as I expected, said the old man. We two have committed a great crime. How can we provide for this child? That's obvious, said Grima. You should be called Cracker, after her, my mother. Now the old man said, How will we provide for this child? The old woman replied, I see a good plan. We'll say that she is our daughter and raise her. No one will believe that, said the old man. This child is much more attractive than we are. We're both completely ugly, and it won't seem likely that the two of us would have such a child, as horrid as we both are. The old woman said, You don't know this, but I have a certain trick to make her seem ugly. I will shave her head and smear it with tar and other things. When her hair is likely to grow back, she shall wear a hood after that. She will also not be well dressed. Then she will take on our appearance. Maybe people will believe that I was very beautiful when I was young, and she shall do the worst chores. The old man and woman thought that she could not speak, for she never answered them. Everything was done as the old woman had planned, and she grew up there in great poverty. Chapter 2 Herod was the name of a powerful and famous jarl in Jotland. He was married. His daughter was named Fora. She was the loveliest of all women in appearance, and the most well-mannered in every possible respect that is better than to have than to be without. She was called Fortress Heart as a nickname, because she excelled all women in beauty, as much as the heart excels over our animals. The jarl greatly loved his daughter. He had a bower made for her, separate from the king's hall, and around that bower was a plank fence. The jarl made it his habit to send his daughter something for amusement every day, and he said that he would continue to do so. Concerning that, it said that he had a little heather snake brought to her one day. Impressively beautiful, this snake pleased her, and she kept it in a little box and placed a piece of gold under it. It had only been there a short while before it had grown greatly, and so the gold underneath it. Then the day came when there was no room inside the box, and it lay in a ring around the box. and it happened later they had no room in the bower, and the gold grew underneath it, just as much as the serpent itself. Now it lay outside around the bower, so it put its head and tail together, and it became hard to deal with. No one dared to come to the bower because of this serpent, except for the person who bought its food, and required an ox for every meal. This seemed to the Jarl to be a great harm, and he swore this oath, that he would give his daughter to that man, whomever he might be, who could kill the serpent, and the gold that was underneath it would be her dowry. This news spread far and wide throughout the land, but no one trusted himself to prevail over his great serpent. Chapter 3. At that time, Sigurd Hering ruled over Denmark. He was a mighty king and had become famous from the battle that he had fought against Harald Wartooth at Brevelir. Harald fell before him, as has become known in all the northern lands of the world. Sigurd had one son, who was called Ragnar. He was grown to great size, handsome in appearance and keen in understanding, generous to his men and fierce to his enemies. As soon as he was old enough, he got himself some men and a warship, and became the greatest warrior, so that hardly anybody was a match for him. He heard that Jarl Hurd had spoken about. He paid no attention and acted as if he didn't know. He had some clothes made for himself of a strange appearance. They were shaggy breeches and a shaggy cape, and once they were made, he had them boiled in tar. Then he hid them. One summer, he led his forces to Gotland and laid up one of his ships in a hidden inlet. It was a short way from there to where the Jarl ruled. When Ragnar had been there one night, he woke early in the morning, got up, and put on the same protective clothes that were mentioned before, and he took a large spear in his hand. He went alone from the ships to where there was sand, and he rolled in the sand. Before he went away, he took a rivet out of his spear. Now he went alone from the ships to the gate of the Jarl's fortress, and arrived there so early in the day that all the men were asleep. He headed for the bower, and there, when he came to the enclosure where the serpent was, he stabbed at it with his spear. Then he quickly pulled the spear back. He stabbed again. That thrust went into the serpent's spine. Then he twisted the spear quickly, so that the spear point came off the shaft. The serpent's death struggles made such a great din that all the bower shook. Now Ragnar turned away. Then a gush of blood struck him between his shoulders. But that didn't hurt him. The clothes that he had made had protected him that well. Those who were in the bower awoke from the noise and came out of the bower. Four saw a large man walking away from the bower and asked him what his name was and what he had come for. He stopped and spoke this verse. I have gambled my glorious life, girl of fair complexion, fought the fish of the land, though 15 winters old. I have conquered Cleven, the cold heath salmon, to the heart, unless his bow should bite, bringing me sudden death. Then he went away and said nothing more to her. The spear point stayed behind in the wound, but he kept the shaft with him. Now that she had heard this verse, she understood what he said about his mission and how old he was. She wondered to herself who he might be. She wasn't sure whether he was human or not, because his size, for his age, seemed to her to be as large as was said about monsters. She turned back into the bower and went to sleep. When the people came out in the morning, they realized what the serpent was lying there dead, with a great spear point sticking fast in the wound. The Jarl had the spear point taken out, and it was so large that few could wield it. Now the Jarl mused on what he had said concerning the man who would slay the serpent. He wasn't sure whether the human being had wielded the spear or not. Now he discussed this with his friends and daughter, how he should look for the man. They thought it likely that the man would seek the reward which he had won. She advised him to have all the people summoned to an assembly, and command that all men should come there who don't want to provoke the Jarl's anger, and who in any way are able to answer the summons. If there's anyone who will avow the serpent's death wound, he will have that spear shaft which fits the point. This seemed like a good idea to the Jarl, and he had the assembly proclaimed. When the day arrived, the Jarl came, and many other chieftains. A great many people were there. Chapter 4. The news was heard on Ragnar's ship, not far from where the assembly had been summoned. Now Ragnar went with all his men from his ship to the assembly. When they came there, they took places somewhat apart from the other men, because Ragnar now saw that a huge crowd had come, larger than usual. Then the Jarl stood up and called for a hearing. He spoke to thank the people for having responded so well to his message. Then he told her the events that had happened. First he spoke about his promise concerning the man who should slay the serpent. Then he said, "The serpent is now dead, and the man who has accomplished this glorious deed has left the spearhead behind, sticking it in the wound. If anyone has come here to the assembly who has a shaft that fits this spearhead, let him bring it forward, and let him prove his report in this way. Then I shall fulfill all that I have promised, whether the man be of higher or lower degree." And he concluded in his speech by having the spearhead borne before each man who was at the assembly, and he ordered that whoever should avow the deed and that shaft which fit should speak up. And so it was done. Not a man was found who had the shaft. Then the spearhead was brought to where Ragnar was and shown to him. He vowed that it was his, and the shaft and the spearhead fit each other. The men realized that he must have been the serpent's killer, and from this deed he became by far the most famous man in all the Northlands. He asked for Thora, the Jarl's daughter, and he welcomed her. She was given in marriage to him, and he was given a great feast with the best provisions in the kingdom. At that feast Ragnar married her, and when the feast was over, Ragnar went to his own kingdom and ruled it. He loved Thora greatly. They had two sons. The elder was named Eric, and Agnar was the younger. They were tall in stature and handsome in appearance. They were much stronger than most other men who were around at that time. They learned all kinds of sports and skills. But one day, Thora felt sick, and she expired from her illness. This was such a great blow to Ragnar that he would not rule the kingdom and appointed other men to rule the kingdom with his sons. He now took up the same occupation that he had before and began raiding. Wherever he went, he won victory. Chapter 5. One summer he set his ship's course for Norway, because he had many kinsmen and friends there and wanted to meet them. He came in his ship that evening to a little harbour. There was a farm which was called Spangereed. A short way from there, Ragnar's men laid up there in the anchorage that night. When morning came, the cooks had to go on land to bake bread. They saw that the farm was a short way ahead of them, and it seemed to them it was more suitable to go to the house and work there. When they came to this little farm, they met a person having a meal. It was an old woman. They asked whether she was the lady of the house and what her name was. She said that she was the lady of the house, and my name's not lacking. I am called Grima. But who are you? They said that they were the servants of Ragnar Lothbrok. They wanted to be about their business. We want you to work with us. The old woman answered that her hands were very stiff, but for me I would do my work well enough, and I have myself a daughter who works with you. She'll come home soon. Her name is Cracker. Things have gotten to the point now that I can hardly manage to control her. Now Cracker had gone with the livestock in the morning, and she saw that many large ships had come to the land. She began to wash herself, though the old woman had forbidden her to do that because she didn't want for men to see her beauty, for she was the loveliest of all women. Her hair was so long that it touched the ground behind her, and as fair as the finest silk. Then Cracker came home. The cooks had made a fire, and Cracker saw that men had come whom she had not been seen before. She looked at them, and they looked at her. Then they asked Grima, "Is that beautiful girl your daughter?" "It's no lie," said Grima. "She is my daughter." "You two must be incredibly unlike," they said. "As hideous as you are, we've never seen a maiden so beautiful. We don't think she looked anything like you, because you are the greatest monstrosity." Grima answered, "You can't see the resemblance to me now. My looks aren't what they used to be." Now they decided that Cracker should work with them. She asked, "What shall I do?" They said that they wanted her to knead the bread, and they then would bake it. She took up her task and did it well. They kept turning to her to stare at her, so that they paid no attention to their job and burned the bread. When they had finished their work, they returned to the ship, and when they had to serve the ship's mess, everyone said that they had never done such a poor job and deserved punishment. Ragnar asked why they had prepared the food that way. They said that they had seen a woman so lovely, they paid no attention to their work, and they supposed that there could be no one more beautiful in the world. When they had finished saying so much about her beauty, Ragnar said that he knew that she could not be as beautiful as Thora had been. They said that she was no less beautiful. Then Ragnar said, "Now I will send men who know how to see clearly. If it is as you say, then your carelessness is forgiven. But if the woman is in any way less beautiful than you have said, you will bring down great punishment on yourselves." And he sent his men to meet this fair maiden. but the headwind was so great that they could not go that day. Ragnar said to the messengers, "If this young maiden seems so lovely as you have has been reported, ask her to come to meet me, and I'll meet with her. I want her to be mine, but I want for her to be neither clad nor unclad, neither sated nor hungry, and for her not to come alone, yet no one may come with her." Now they travelled until they came to the house, and they observed Cracker carefully, and the woman seemed so lovely to them, they thought that no other was as beautiful. Then they told her the message from their Lord Ragnar, but how she should be prepared. Cracker thought about what the king had said, and how she should prepare herself, but Grimer thought there was no way that this could be done, and she said that she knew that this king could not be wise. Cracker said, "He must have said this because it can be done. If we can figure out what he meant, then, but I certainly cannot travel with you today. I'll come to a ship early in the morning." Then they went away and told Ragnar how it was arranged, and she would come to meet them. Cracker stayed at home that night, but early in the morning she said to the old woman that she had to go meet Ragnar, "But I must alter my costume somewhat. You have a fishing net for trout, and I'll wrap that around myself. I'll let my hair fall down over it, and then I shall be bare nowhere. I will taste a leek, and that is little food, and yet will recognize that I have eaten. And I must have your dog follow me. I won't go alone, yet no person will come with me." When the old woman heard her plans, she realized that she was very intelligent. When Cracker was ready, she went on her way until she came to the ship. Her appearance was lovely, and her hair was as bright as gold. Ragnar called to her and asked who she might be and whom she wanted to meet. She replied with a verse, "I don't dare to refuse the decree that I must come, nor break with your bidding to be here, Lord Ragnar. No man stand beside me, and my skin is not bare. I have my fine following, though. I fared here alone." Now he sent men to meet her and had her lead them onto his ship, but she said that she didn't want to go unless she and her fellow traveller were greeted safe conduct. Then she was led into the king's ship, and when she came onto the deck, Ragnar reached out his hands to her, but the dog bit his hand. His men rushed at the dog and beat it and throttled it with a bowstring, and that killed it. She was no better safe conduct than that. Ragnar seated her on the after deck next to himself and talked with her. She suited his mind well, and he was happy with her. He spoke a verse. "If the fatherland's defender to the fine lady were kind, truly she would take me, tender in her arms." She said, "If you respect safe conduct, surely you will let me go home from here unblemished, though a helmsman I have sought." Chapter 6. He now said that he was pleased with her, and he truly wanted her to come with him. She said that she could not. Then he said that he wanted her to be there on his ship that night. She said that that could not happen before he returned from the journey that he intended. "And maybe that by then something else will seem better to you." Then Ragnar called his treasurer and asked him to take a shirt that Thor had owned, all embroidered with gold, and presented to her. Ragnar offered it to Cracker in this way. "Will you take this shirt, which Thor a Heart once had, sewn about with silver? It suits you very well. Her pale hands once passed over his precious garment, she was kind until death to this king of blithe heroes." Cracker replied, "I don't dare take the shirt which Thor a Heart once had, sewn about with silver, which suits me his shabby clothing, for I'm called Cracker in coal black clothes, who goes over the gravel, driving goats with me." "And I certainly don't want to accept the shirt," she said. "I won't dress myself in finery while I live with the old man. It may be that you would like me better if I dressed myself better. I want to go home now, but you may send me men after me if you still have the same thing in mind and you want me to go with you." Ragnar said that he would not change his mind, and she went home. Ragnar and his men left as they had planned as soon as they had a favourable wind, and he discharged his errands as he had intended. When he returned, he came to the same harbour where he had been before when Cracker came to him. That same evening, he sent men to find her and give her Ragnar's message that she should leave now for good, but she said that she could not leave before morning. Cracker got up early and went to the old couple's bed and asked whether they were awake. They said that they were awake and asked what she wanted. She said she intended to go away and stay there no longer. "I know you killed Hamir, my foster father, and I want to pay back no one but you. For the sake of the long time that I will live with you, too, I will not do you any harm. But I now pronounce that each day will be worse for you than those you have passed, and your last day will be the worst. Now we are parted. Then she went on her way to the ships and was welcomed warmly. They had good weather. That same evening, when the men had to make up their beds, Ragnar said that he wanted them to sleep together, but she said that to her that could not be. And I want you to hold a wedding feast for me. When you come to your kingdom, that seems to me to be honourable, for me as well as for you and for our heirs, if we should have any. He granted her this favour, and they travelled well. Ragnar now came home to his own land, and a lavish feast was spread for him, and both the welcome ale in his honour and his wedding ale were drunk. And the first evening, as they shared a bed, Ragnar wanted to couple with his wife. She excused herself. She said that she would suffer consequences if she didn't get her way. Ragnar said that he could not believe that, and he said that the old man and woman couldn't see the future. He asked how long they should wait. She said, "For 3 nights, we two, though together in the hall, shall sleep separately here. We sacrifice to holy gods. This delay will do no damage to my child. You're brash to beget one whose bones will be lacking." Although she said that, Ragnar gave it no heed and disregarded her advice. Chapter 7. Now time went by, and their marriage was good and very loving. Cracker found that she was pregnant and gave birth to a boy child. The boy was sprinkled with water and given the name Ivar. But the boy was boneless, as if there were gristle where the bone should be. When he was young, he was grown so large that no one was his equal. He was the handsomest of all men, and so wise that he wasn't certain whether they were ever going to be wiser than him. They were destined to have more children. Their second son was named Bjorn. The third was Vitsek, and the fourth was Rongvald. They were all great men and the most valiant. As soon as they could do anything, they took up all sorts of sports. And wherever they went, Ivar had them carry him on poles, because he couldn't walk. He would make plans for what they should do. Now Erik and Agnar, Ragnar's sons, were such great and mighty men, their equals could hardly be found. They rented their warships every summer and were renowned for their raiding. And one day, Ivar was discussing with his brothers, Vitsek and Bjorn, how much longer they would sit at home and not seek any fame for themselves. They said that they would act on his advice, in that as in the other things. Ivar said, "Now I want us to ask for ships and men, so that they may be well crewed. They don't want us to gain wealth and fame for ourselves, if it may happen this way." When they discussed this plan among themselves, they said to Ragnar that they wanted him to get them ships and crews that were experienced at raiding and were prepared for anything. He did what they asked. Once their men were ready, they sailed away from their land. Wherever they battled with men, they got more loot, and they won for themselves both a great host of men and great riches. Then Ivar said that he wanted them to head for where a more powerful force could challenge them, so they would test their own prowess. They asked where he knew of this possibility. He named a place called Vidabir, where sacrifices were made. Many have attempted to conquer it, and none have gained victory. Ragnar had gone there, but had been turned back and accomplished nothing. "Are the forces there so large and so strong," they said, "or are there other obstacles?" Ivar said that both very large forces and a great place for sacrifices were there. Of all those who had attacked it, not one had withstood that. They said that he should decide whether they should head for that place or not, but he said that he wanted to test which might be greater, their own hardiness or the sorcery of the inhabitants. Chapter 8. Now they set their course for that place for when they came to land. They made ready to go ashore. It occurred to them that they needed some men to guard the ships. Rongvald, their brother, was young then, and they didn't think he was ready to run such a great risk as they thought was likely. They left him to watch over the ships with some men. Before they left their ships, Ivar said that the townspeople had 2 cows, and they were young bulls. Men turned and fled from them, and they could not withstand their bellowing and their dreadful magic power. Ivar said, "Brace yourselves as best you can, although you feel some unease, because nothing will hurt you." Then they deployed their forces. As they approached the town, they realized that the people who lived there were about to release the cattle that they worshipped. And when the bulls were let loose, they rushed forward ferociously and bellowed wickedly. Ivar saw that from the shield there was no, that was where he was being carried. He asked his men to fetch him his bow, and they did. Then he shot the evil bulls and killed them both. The enemy, which seemed most terrifying, was dispelled by his hand. Rongvald began to speak back at the ships. He said to his men, they would be so lucky to have such entertainment as his brothers were having. There's no reason why I should stay behind, except they wanted to have the glory to themselves. Now we should all go up. And they did so. When they came upon the armies, Rongvald charged fiercely into the battle, and in the end he was killed. But the brothers broke through into the town, and the battle began again. In the end, the townsmen turned and fled, and they pursued the fleeing men. When they turned back to the town, Bjorn spoke a verse. Our blades bit more than theirs, our battle cry was raised. I must tell this truly, there on the Glimpner Ford, that every man who would like to, lads, don't spare your swords now. Become, before Hidverbear, the bane of a foeman. When they came back to the town, they took all the treasure, burned every house in town, and tore down all the walls. Then they sailed the ships away. Chapter 9. The king who ruled Sweden was named Einstein. He was married and had one daughter. Her name was Ingeborg. She was the fairest and finest of all women. King Einstein was powerful and had many retainers. He was ill-tempered and yet wise. He had his royal residence in Uppsala. He was a great sacrificer, and at Uppsala at that time there were so many sacrifices that there have never been more in the Northlands. They had great faith in a certain cow, and they called her Zibelja. She received so many sacrifices that men could not withstand her bellowing. It was a king's custom, when an invasion was expected, this very same cow went in front of the ranks. So much devilry followed her that her enemies lost their senses. As soon as they heard her, they fought each other and took no heed for themselves. For that reason, Sweden was never subject to invasion. For men didn't dare test themselves against such overwhelming odds. King Einstein was good friends with many men and chieftains, and it is said at that time there was great friendship between Ragnar and King Einstein. It was their custom that each summer one of them should go and feast with the other. Now it so happened that Ragnar had to go and feast with King Einstein. When he came to Uppsala, he and his men were well received. When they began drinking, at the start of the evening, the king had his daughter serve drink to himself and to Ragnar. Ragnar's men said among themselves there was nothing else he should do but ask for King Einstein's daughter, and he should not be married any longer to a peasant's daughter. It happened that one of his men brought this up with him, and in the end the woman was promised to him, although she would stay betrothed to him for a very long time. When the feast was ended, Ragnar prepared to go home, and he travelled well. There was nothing to say about his journey until he was only a short distance from his royal seat, when he led his forces into a forest. They came upon a clearing in the forest. Then Ragnar ordered his men to halt and called for a hearing for himself. Then he commanded all the men being on his voyage to Sweden not to speak about his future plans of a marriage with King Einstein's daughter. He gave a strict order about this. If anyone spoke of this matter, he would lose nothing less than his life. Now that he had said what he wanted to, he went home to his estate. Men rejoiced that he had come back and drank the welcome ale in his honour. He came to his seat and had not sat there long before Cracker came into the hall. She came before Ragnar and sat on his knee, laid her arms around his neck, and asked, "What is the news?" But he said that he knew nothing to tell. When the evening came, the men began drinking. Later, they went to sleep. When Ragnar and Cracker got into bed together, she asked him again for the news, but he said that he knew nothing. Now she wanted to chat more, but he said that he was very sleepy and weary from travelling. Now I'll tell you the news, she said, if you don't want to tell me anything. He asked what it was. I call it news, she said. If a woman is promised to a king, but yet some men are saying that he already has another woman. Who told you that? Said Ragnar. Your men shall keep their lives and limbs, because no man told me this, she said. You must have seen that three kids was birds were sitting in a tree next to you. They told me the news. I beg you not to try this plan that you have devised. Now I must tell you that I am a king's daughter, not a peasant's, and my father was such a renowned man that his equal has never been attained, and my mother was the loveliest and wisest of all women, and her name will be remembered while the world lasts. He asked who her father was, if she wasn't the daughter of the poor old man who lived in Spangered. She said that she was a daughter of Sigurd, Fafnir's bane, and Brynhild, Brynhild's daughter. Ragnar said, it seems to be highly unlikely that their daughter would be named Cracker, or that their child would grow up in such poverty as there was at Spangereid. Then she answered, here is the story, and began to tell the tale of how Sigurd and Brynhild met on the mountain, and how she was begotten. And when Brynhild gave birth, a name was given to me, and I was called Aslaug. And she told everything that had happened to her since they met the old man. Ragnar answered, I'm amazed at these wild tales you tell about Aslaug. She replied, you know that I'm pregnant, and it must be a boy child that I am carrying. On that child there will be a mark, which will look like a serpent lying in the child's eyes. If this happens, as I have said, I ask you not to go to Sweden at the time when you are to marry the daughter of King Eystein. If it fails, then go wherever you will, but I want this child to be named after my father. If that mark of the glory is in his eyes, as I believe it will be. The time came when she went into labour and gave birth to a boy child. A serving woman took the child and showed him to her. She said that they should bear him to Ragnar and let him see, and it was done. The young child was brought into the hall and laid on Ragnar's lap. When he saw the boy, he was asked how he would name him. He spoke a verse. The child should be called Sigurd. He hold court in battles, much like his own mother's mighty father shall he be. Of all Odin's kindred, he will be accounted best. Showing a snake in his eye, he will be a slayer of many. Now he took a gold ring off his own hand and gave it to the boy as a name gift. When he held out his hand with the gold, he touched the boy's back, and Ragnar took that to mean that the boy would hate gold. Now he spoke this verse. The dear son of Brynhild's daughter, pleasing to heroes, has flashing faced stones and a most faithful heart. The bringer of Banefire wins battles by his strength. Brynhild's daughter, descendant, disdains the red gold rings. And he said further, I see no young swain except Sigurd alone. Bridles laid in bright stones, the brows borderland. The daring beast, day diminisher, is discerned by this mark. The dark forest ring flashed from the fences of his eyelids. Now he said they should take the child out into the bower. Then his plan to go to Sweden was broken off, and the lineage of Aslaug was revealed, that every man knew that she was the daughter of Sigurd Fafnir's bane and Brynhild, Brynhild's daughter. Chapter 10. Now the time had passed when Ragnar had to come to the feast of Uppsala, as agreed, but he didn't come. That seemed to King Eystein to be an insult to himself and his daughter, and the king's friendship was broken off. When Eirik and Agnar, Ragnar's sons, heard that, they made plans together to get a great host of themselves, as large as they could, and raid in Sweden. They got together a large force of men and made their ship ready. They believed that their success would strongly depend on whether going well when the ship set out. As it happened, when Agnar's ship was launched from the rollers, there was a man in front of it, and he was killed. They caught at the roller red. Now it seemed to them that things had not gone well as at the start. But they didn't want to let that stand in the way of their journey. And when their forces were ready, and they went with their men to Sweden, and they bore the war shields. When they first entered the kingdom of King Eystein, the landing men found out that went up to Uppsala and told King Eystein that a host had come into the land. The king had the war arrow sent throughout the kingdom and summoned such a large host that it was a wonder. Then he advanced his forces until he came to a forest, and he pitched his tents there. He now had the cow Sibylla with him, and she received many sacrifices before she was willing to travel. When they were in the forest, King Eystein spoke. I have found out, he said, that Ragnar's sons are in the fields directly in front of the forest, and I have been told truly that they are not a third of the forces we have. Now we should divide out our ranks for the battle. One third of our men shall advance against them. They are so bold that they will think that they have the business well in hand. Then we shall attack them with full forces, and the cow will go in front of the army, and I expect that they shall not withstand her bellowing. And so it was done. As soon as the brothers saw King Eystein's force, they thought that it wouldn't be too powerful to deal with. and didn't suppose that his forces might be larger. Suddenly all of his hosts came out of the forest. The cow was turned loose, and she charged in front of the ranks and bellowed horribly. And there was such great confusion among the fighters who heard it, they fought each other, except for the two brothers who managed to hold out. The evil creature gored many men with her horns that day. Though the sons of Ragnar were mighty, they could not withstand both such overwhelming forces and such sorcery. Although they put up stiff resistance and defended themselves well, with bravery and great renown. Irak and Agnar were in the forefront of the ranks that day. They often broke through the battle lines of King Eystein. Then Agnar fell. Irak saw that, and he bore himself more bravely than ever. I didn't care whether he survived or not, but he was surrounded by an overpowering force and captured. Now Eystein said that the battle would stop, and he offered a truce to Irak. "I'll grant you this as well," he said. "I'll give you my daughter's hand in marriage." Irak spoke averse. "I won't take my brother's blood money, nor buy a maid with rings. It's now that Eystein has become Agnar's bane. My mother won't mourn me. I'll mount up above the slain. The ravenous spear shaft skewer me right through." He said that he wanted the men who had followed him and Agnar to have safe conduct and to go wherever they wanted. "But I want as many spears as possible to be taken and be stuck down in the ground. And there I shall have myself lifted up on them, and there I'll lay down my life." King Eystein said that what he had asked for would be done, although he had made the worst choice for both of them. Now the points of the spears were set down, and Erik spoke a verse. "No king's son shall ever so know my sentence, die on a dearer bed. A day's meal for the raven, the soot-black blood-seeker, will soon scream over the brothers. Rip apart the pair of them, though it's a poor reward." Now he went to the place where the spears were set down. He took a ring from his hand and threw it to those men who had followed him and had been given safe conduct. He dispatched them to Aslaug and spoke a verse. "Fair with my final words, finished our eastern journeys. The slender lady Aslaug may own my hoard of rings. There will be the fiercest fury when they find out my death. My stepmother speaks of it. A son so gentle." And now he was heaped up on the spears, and he saw a raven flying, and he said to it, "Now the slash gull soars high, screaming over my head. The wound falcon wishes my warm unseeing eyes. Know if the bird should break the brow stones from my head. The raven pays me poorly for plenty of Ekil's bounty." Now he laid down his life with great courage, but his messengers went home and didn't stop until they came to where Ragnar at his royal seat. At the time he had gone to a meeting of kings. Ragnar's sons had also not come home from raiding. The messengers were there for 3 nights, for they went with Aslaug. When they came before Aslaug's high seat, they greeted her respectfully, and she began to speak with them. She had a linen kerchief on her knees, and meant to comb her hair. She had let her hair down. Now she asked who they were, for she had not seen them before. The one who spoke for them said that they had been warriors of Irak and Agnar, Ragnar's sons. Then she spoke a verse. "What tidings do you tell, trusted friend of kings? Are the Swedes a sailing, or perhaps sent packing? I see that Danes have sailed from the south, northwards, the Hildings, and Red Rollers. I have no further knowledge." He spoke a verse in reply. "We must say to you, lady, what is sorely of distressing. Slain are the two sons of Thora. Sad the fates of your men. No other new tidings, we know, are heavy as these. I have come from hearing the news, over the corpse flies the eagle." She asked what had happened. He spoke that verse which Erik had spoken when he sent the ring to her. They saw that she shed a tear. It looked like blood, and was as hard as a hailstone. No one had ever seen her shed a tear, neither nor before nor since. Now she said that she could not plan vengeance before one of the other came home. Ragnar or his sons. "But you shall stay here till then. I will not fail to urge them to take revenge just as if they were my own sons." And they stayed there, since it so happened that Ivar and his brothers came home before Ragnar. They were not home long before Aslaug went to meet her sons. Sigurd was 3 years old at the time, and he went with his mother. And when she came into the hall, where the brothers were having their discussion, they greeted her warmly. They asked for any other news, and they spoke about the fall of her son Rongvald, and about the events which had happened there, but that news didn't affect her much, and she said, "My sons left me to stare at the seagull's land, A long time you've been gaddling about, going around begging. One of us soaked his shield in the same warrior's blood, and dead on a threat to end him, my fine son, the youngest. "I cannot see," she said, "how he could have lived for greater glory." And they asked what news she had. She answered, "The fool being of Agnar, my brothers and my stepsons, and many who are the best of warriors by the way. Not surprising that you refused to tolerate such a thing. You sent a terrible vengeance. Ask us of you, and I'll assist you with our revenge, to be greater, rather than less." "How was it? This is certain, I will never come to Sweden for the purpose of fighting for Einstein, and the sorceress is there." She pressed him, Ivar spoke for them, and all completely refused to take the village. Then she spoke of us. "Had you been first of all, without fail, you would not be my lacking vengeance, delayed for half a year, Erup and Agnar. I'll conceal a little, brethren, like one of me, still do breathe and live." "It's not certain," said Ivar, "whether that helps your case at all. How you speak one verse after another. How clearly do you know what sort of defences we would be facing?" "I don't know that certainly," she said. "What can you say about the obstacles there?" Ivar said that there was such great sorcery that no one said that they had ever heard the like that could exist. And the king is both powerful and wicked. What is he worship most to sacrifice? He said it's a great cow, and she is called Silija. She has been made so powerful that as soon as men hear her bellowing, his enemies cannot withstand it. It is hardly as if we shall be battling with men alone. Rather, I think, that first we shall encounter sorcery before we meet the king, and I will risk myself more than men. She said, "You might realize that you cannot be called the greatest of men if you don't strive for it." And as it seemed to her that it was in vain, she meant to leave. She thought that she didn't set much store to by her words. Then Sigurd, snake in the eye, spoke. "I must tell you, mother," he said, "what is in my mind, though I may not change their answers." "I will listen to that," she said. Now he spoke a verse. "It will take us 3 nights. If you are troubled, mother, far must be our care for faring. Our forces be ready. They dare aid us. Einstein the king shall not hold up Sala's high seat, though hoarded wealthy offer." When he had spoken this verse, the brothers' minds began to change somewhat. "Now Aslab," said, "you have made it known that you will do my will, my son, but I cannot see how we too will go on this journey if we don't have help from your brothers. Yet it may turn out that this deed will be avenged. It seems best to me, I think, it is good that you go by my son." And now Bjorn spoke a verse. "A hawk keen breast holding, bold heart and mind within, aids a man, though he make but little mention of it. Though no snakes nor serpents shimmer in our own eyes, my brothers made me merry. Remember your stepsons." Now Witzek spoke a verse. "Let's plan before we promise, plot to wreak our vengeance. Be blithe that Agnar's banesmen must bear a host of arms. Let's shove the boat off from shore, shatter ice before the prow. See how soon we can get our sailing ships outfitted." Witzek advised that they should break the ice because the river was hard frozen and the ships were trapped in the ice. Now Ivar began to speak, and he said that things had come to the point that he must take part if he spoke a verse. "You all boast of boundless bravery and daring, and as you all need is great tenacity as well. I'll be hoisted above heroes because I have no bones, yet I'll have a hand in vengeance, whichever I make use of." "Now is the time," said Ivar, "for us to start planning, as best we can, to provision our ships and to summon a war host, as we all need to leave nothing out, but to be victorious." And Aslaug went away. Well, that was part one of the Saga of Ragnar Lothbrok and his sons, chapters 1 to 10. That took longer than I thought. Chapter 10 was a really long chapter. But I hope you enjoyed it. And join me again for part two, which will only be chapters 11 to 15. I'm going to keep it short from now on. Stay safe, have fun, enjoy. Goodbye.